Good morning, friends. Welcome back. In our previous lecture, we discussed about level flight performance, and we have come up with a subroutine where we identified what should be the thrust required and the power required when you fly at different velocities, and what will be the corresponding trim angle of attack and control surface deflection required. At the same time, we also looked at aerodynamic parameters like CL by CD and CL power 3 by 2 by CD and its variation with velocity, or you can also say the trim angle of attack, right. For that, what we did is we considered a trim angle of attack, and then we talked about, we estimated using that CM and CL equation, we estimated what should be the delta E trim from CM naught equation, right, sorry, CM equation, which talks about static pitching moment for the longitudinal case. From for equilibrium, you equated that equation to 0 and then figured out what is delta E trim. From using the delta E trim and the initial considered alpha trim in CL equation, right, the aerodynamic model I am talking about, CL naught plus CL alpha times alpha trim plus CL delta E times delta E trim. From there, you figured out what should be the corresponding CL trim that you need to maintain. In order to maintain that CL trim, you have to fly at a particular velocity to generate lift is equals to weight. That is one of our level flight condition, right. So, from there you can figure out what should be the velocity for that particular trim condition or to maintain CL trim. Once you get velocity, now you have CL trim, now figure, we can also figure out the corresponding CD for that CL trim, which is CD using drag polar, which is CD naught plus KCL square, right. So, CL there will be replaced by CL trim. Once you have CD and you know what is the velocity, now you can figure out what is the thrust required, which is nothing but drag, that is equals to half rho v square s CD, right. So, you know both the variables V and CD in that particular equation. So, once you know power thrust required, you can proceed to figure out what is power required, which is thrust required times the velocity of flight, right. So, for when you start this entire procedure to solve this entire steps, so you are trying to vary the angle of attack, right. So, that is considered as an input for this entire steps. And then we also solved for what should be the CL upon CD for that particular alpha trim and its variation, right. So, we also talked about CL power 3 by 2 by CD. We just want to see how the power required condition depends upon CL power 3 by 2 by CD, right, and thrust required condition depends upon aerodynamic efficiency CL upon CD, right. So, we have solved for both the, we have solved for all these variables and its variation with velocity. So, let us now proceed with the same example to figure out what will be the power required or power required for takeoff as well as what is power required for climb, right. So, why are we doing this exercise? So, the reason is simple. If we consider a typical flight envelope of a UAV, right, let us assume it is not a hand launch model. So, what you have is a ground roll, say takeoff, so on ground it will try to run, right, and then it will try to rotate. So, what, so the time period for which this remains on the ground, the aircraft runs on the ground, we consider it as ground roll followed by a rotation. And then it starts climbing to the desired altitude, right. So, what we call it as climb. And then from there you start performing your mission, which is majorly dominated by cruise. And then say there can be loiter. So, but why we are doing this exercise is because we try to now figure out what should be the power requirement for by the system at each and every phase, thereby you can select a particular power plant that satisfies the power requirement or the thrust requirement of all these flight envelopes. So, let us now proceed with the same example what I discussed. So, by doing that we will actually solve, again we are going to again come up with a subroutine that helps us to estimate the power requirement for level takeoff during takeoff condition as well as climb condition. And now we will try to ignore this particular portion, the rotation portion, power requirement during rotation, which is very minimal for unmanned aerial vehicles, right. So, let us take up the example problem. Instead of just doing it in a generalized manner, we will try to solve it using an example problem, right. So, what we are going to talk about is subroutine 2. Let us assume the first one is subroutine, the earlier example that we solved is subroutine 1. Let us talk about subroutine 2, okay. So, consider this is the question. We will take it as a general question and then we will solve it, we take it as an example and then we solve it for general purpose as well. So, consider the delta wing UAV presented in example 1, that is our previous example where we talked about level flight performance, right. So, has to take off from a bitumen runway with, or you can say bitumen runway located at an altitude. So, let us also give the details about this frictional coefficient on the runway with a frictional coefficient of frictional coefficient of 0.05. So, runway located at an altitude of 1000 meters with respect to MSL, mean sea level, okay. So, the runway itself, the geographic location of this runway itself is 1 kilometer altitude, right, is at an altitude of 1 kilometer. So, find the power required or say to be delivered by the brushless motor with a propeller efficiency of 0.95 during takeoff when the takeoff angle of attack alpha takeoff, let us assume, okay, let me write it down for the first time, angle of attack during takeoff is maintained as 5 degrees, okay. So, this is our question. We need to figure out what is the power requirement during takeoff for this particular UAV which was presented in example 1. What was that UAV? We talked about a delta wing UAV. So, we talked about drop delta wing UAV. So, this is the delta wing UAV that we are talking about, which has a root chord of 0.9 meters and tip chord of 0.15 meters. So, and then the span of 1.5 meters, okay. So, you can refer to our previous example where we talked about this. So, the lambda for this is 0.167 and aspect ratio, which is b square by s, which turned out to be 2.86 and the reference area is b by 2, again writing it down, 1 plus lambda. So, it turned out to be 0.787 meter square, okay. So, do we need any other details? And we also have the aerodynamic details which you can refer from our previous question. So now the important thing that we need to observe here is, so it has a frictional coefficient, the frictional coefficient between the tires of the aircraft and then of the UAV, and then the this bitumen runway is about 0.05, right? So 0.05, and we the details of propeller efficiency is also given, right? So we do you remember when the so in our previous course we have discussed about what is the output from a reciprocating engine or a brushless motor. So the output here you have is shaft power PS, right? So this is a mechanical power that is available from this brushless motor. So now you need to attach a propeller to it in order to convert this available mechanical power to useful aerodynamic power or power useful for aircraft to move forward. So that we will call it as power available. So the efficiency of the propeller is given as output. What is the output here from this system is power available, right? So power available is the output. Output upon input, input is shaft power. So output upon input is the efficiency of this propeller, which is power available upon power shaft power, right? So what we need to identify is what will be the corresponding shaft power that this particular brushless motor need to deliver, okay, for this aircraft to take off from a runway, right? So now the usual operation of this particular UAV is from an altitude of 1 kilometer, right? That means what is what is going to affect us is the density of the air, right, that we have to consider at that particular altitude. Now let us look at what is this takeoff scenario, right? So let us say it's a wing alone configuration. If you remember properly, this is my runway. So let me draw the side view of this aircraft. Yeah, so it's all movable vertical tail, and then you have the nose wheel, and the trike. Yeah, you have this trike, right? Now let us assume a reference axis, which is nothing but the chord line for this UAV, right? It's a wing alone configuration. So when the aircraft is on ground roll, right, when it is doing a ground roll here, that is moving on this runway, so your direction is parallel to this ground, right? So the fluid stream velocity that you will encounter will also be parallel to this ground, and your aircraft orientation is constant, isn't it, because of the tires, right, because of this undercarriage, the way you designed the undercarriage. So the orientation of this aircraft remained constant when you are running on this runway during the ground roll, and the velocity will be parallel to your flight path in general. So the flight path here is nothing but the direct parallel to runway, right? So zero, right? So this is your free stream velocity and this is your reference axis. That means you maintain a particular angle of attack which is almost constant during the ground run, right? So that means you need, what you need to understand, the alpha that you are maintaining during ground run is constant, thereby forcing the CL has to remain constant during this runway, ground run, okay? So in general, if you will just look at the dynamic equations and then we will discuss discuss further. So let us say this is the direction of the thrust, let us say in the direction of V infinity, T is the direction. So let us say T is acting in this direction, what you have is drag due to this, right, and then you generate lift perpendicular to flight velocity and the weight of the aircraft acting downward, right, isn't it? So the weight of aircraft or the UAV is acting vertically down. So again, L is acting perpendicular to V infinity and V infinity is parallel to the ground. So L and W are along the same axis but in opposite direction, right? And D is in the direction of V infinity during this ground run, right? Apart from this, what you have is friction, which is retarding the motion, that is acting in the opposite direction of the motion, which is mu times W minus L. So when the aircraft is completely at rest, there is no drag and lift. So what you have is W, mu times W, right? Mu times the reaction, reaction is nothing but the total weight of the aircraft acting, but in the opposite direction, right? So coming back to this, now we know for takeoff, so the UAV has to accelerate from zero to takeoff velocity, right? Isn't it? So that is what a typical acceleration that we look at within over a period of time, right? So now, if you look at the dynamic equation, so the total acceleration should be equals to t is in the direction. So the acceleration that we produce will be in the direction of motion, right? That is along the thrust here. T minus d minus mu times W minus L, right? So let us say this is the acceleration that I am looking at, so should be equal to the total force, forward force minus the total retarding force, which is drag and the frictional force here, and then the lift has to be balanced by weight. So at takeoff, this is the condition that you can achieve, right? When your lift is balanced by the weight, you are now no more running on the ground, right? You are airborne. Okay. So, until we achieve that particular condition, we have to make our UAV run on the runway, and then once you reach that particular velocity which enables you to produce a lift which is greater than the weight, then you are airborne and the frictional force disappears at that particular point. So, till that we need to produce power which will satisfy this frictional drag or the friction that we encounter here. So, now how do you find out what is the power required during this particular phase, isn't it? So let us say this thrust that has to be generated by the engine here, isn't it? So the thrust that I need to generate by this brushless motor is equals to mass times the acceleration that I need to give to this aircraft for takeoff, right? For takeoff I need to produce acceleration, so that is m times a, plus I need to satisfy the drag when I am flying, moving at a particular velocity. I need to satisfy the requirement of the system, which is drag here, and then apart from that there is frictional force, right? Because I am running on the ground right now, so which is mu times W minus L. So this is the power or the thrust I have to generate if I have to move at, if I have to achieve a takeoff velocity with this particular acceleration, right? And then, so the power that I need to deliver from this, or the power required by the system, is equals to, which is the thrust required times the velocity, as we know very well. So the velocity here we will consider as thrust required times V takeoff velocity, right? So why we are doing this? It will be higher, right? Power required will be higher at higher takeoff velocity. We want to know what is the maximum power required during this takeoff process, isn't it? So that means we need to look for, if the engine can deliver that maximum power, it always can satisfy anything lesser than that, right, by just adjusting the throttle of the engine. So now I will be able to figure out what is the power required given what is thrust required during the takeoff from this particular runway, which is equals to, which has to satisfy again the acceleration that you require to produce, and then the drag as well as the frictional force. Okay, let us now proceed to further to understand what is this takeoff velocity based up, what is this takeoff velocity from aerodynamic point of view, right? What should be the takeoff velocity? So now we have again this CL is equals to CL naught plus CL alpha into alpha. In general, if you refer any of the standard textbooks in related to flight dynamics, so the takeoff velocity is in general given as 1.2 times of V stall velocity, assuming you. So what is stall velocity? So, which is given by, so CL max, which we discussed many times, right? So stall velocity corresponds to CL max. That means if I make this CL max, and what I assume is I am flying at alpha stall. But who is producing that alpha stall? The aircraft orientation, isn't it? But on ground, when you come back to this again, this scenario again, so on ground this alpha is fixed, isn't it? That is what we discussed earlier. When it is running on the ground, this alpha is fixed. But for UAVs, I don't think it is feasible for most of the UAVs, small scale UAVs, I don't think it is feasible to have flaps, dedicated flaps to produce that CL max, which is the case for a commercial aircraft, right? So I don't think that's possible. So what we have to look at is a practical way of understanding the power requirement during takeoff. Instead of adapting to this standard procedure of calculating what is the V stall required based upon CL max and then the 1.2 times of V stall, what we do is, instead of stall angle of attack, what we will say is CL prime during takeoff is equals to CL alpha times alpha during takeoff. So this is nothing but alpha during takeoff. Okay. So because the orientation is fixed when it is, when the UAV is running on ground, hence the angle of attack has to be a constant value here, right? This is alpha takeoff. So for this particular alpha takeoff, what will be the corresponding CL that I can achieve without flap deflection, and elevators are not effective to change the orientation when it is running on the ground, right? And there is no point of doing that. So the corresponding V prime during this takeoff procedure is square root of 2W. Again, it has to satisfy. I need to run, or I need to take my aircraft to a velocity where it is able to produce the lift which is equivalent to weight of this aircraft, which can lift the weight of the aircraft, right? So there should be a force that can lift the weight, or equivalent produce, we should produce a force which is opposite to the in the opposite direction of weight, and you, for that you need to make your aircraft achieve a particular velocity, which is V takeoff velocity. What we will call it is V takeoff square S times CL prime is equals to W, right? So the CL prime is now defined by this alpha takeoff, which is a which depends upon the orientation of your aircraft during the ground roll, right? And then once you have the CL prime, you will be able to find out what is V prime square. So from here, 2W by S upon rho CL prime. So once you have V prime, then we will adapt to this. V takeoff is equals to 1.2 times of V prime, okay? So that we will consider that this is a factor of safety, right? 1.2 times of V prime. So that when you substitute in this particular equation, you will be satisfying lift is equals to weight, more definitely more than weight here, okay? Because V takeoff is higher than that CL prime square, isn't it? So V takeoff condition is higher compared to that of the velocity that you need to maintain for CL prime. So this will definitely ensure that you are off the ground, you are airborne, this particular condition, okay? That is when you can change your orientation. Once you are airborne, then your control surfaces are effective, and then you can change the orientation of this aircraft, okay? So now we will look at the procedure a bit more in detail. We will write down the steps how to solve this. And moreover, you see this takeoff velocity depends upon density, right? And all our calculations depends upon density, because we are talking about aerodynamic forces. And don't you think, is it not mandatory for us to come up with a subroutine that talks about variation of density with altitude, right? So when we are talking that, what do we remember? Standard atmosphere, right? So before solving this particular example problem, I would like to come up with a subroutine that talks about, density, like given an altitude of flight as an input, I will get density, pressure and the temperature as an output, right? So what we are going to talk is subroutine for standard atmosphere. So most of our flights are limited to say about 13 kilometers, right? So let's try to come up with the subroutine for the first two layers of standard atmosphere. We know this is the altitude and this is in kilometers, right? This is on x axis, we have temperature, when the altitude is varied, what is the change in temperature? That is what the standard atmosphere talks about. So we have temperature in Kelvin, right? On the vertical axis we have altitude in kilometers. So at sea level, say at 0 kilometers to 11 kilometers, we know it is governed by gradient layer equations, where there is a slope here, right, which is called dT upon dH, right. It is given by dT upon dH, not dH upon dT. Please understand, please make a note of it just for the visualization purpose and to make plotting the altitude on the vertical axis make more sense, right, isn't it? So altitude on vertical axis make more sense, that is the only reason why this is plotted in this manner. But in general, this data is acquired by means of varying the altitude and measuring the corresponding temperature, density and temperature and pressure at those altitudes. Okay. So the lapse rate here is given as dT upon dH, which is Kelvin upon Kelvin per kilometer minus 6.5 for the first gradient layer, which is Kelvin per kilometer. Okay. And then from 11 kilometers to 25 kilometers, what we have is isothermal layer. So the first layer is, this is gradient layer, and what we have is isothermal layer. Okay. So up to 25 kilometers. Okay. So the constant temperature regime. So at T at 0 altitude is 288.16 Kelvin. Right. At this particular altitude of 11 kilometers is 216.66 Kelvin. Okay. Right. So let us now come up with the subroutine. So before this, we will just recollect what are our gradient layer equations. So the for gradient layer, which is characterized by the slope lapse rate, what we call is dT upon dH, which is T2 minus T1 upon H2 minus H1, right. So where H is, and then so T at a particular altitude T2 given T1 is T1 plus A times delta H. Okay. So this is one equation that gives me the information about temperature at a altitude, right. And then what I have is gradient layer equations, which is P is equals to, or P2 is equals to P1 times T2 upon T1 raised to the power of minus G naught by AR. Okay. And then rho 2 is equals to rho 1 at rho at sea level, let us say, for the first gradient layer T1, rho P1 and rho R1 is rho at mean sea level, right. So that is T1 is equals to 288.16 Kelvin at P1 is equals to 1 atmosphere, which is 1.01325 times 10 to the power of 5 Pascal or Newton per meter square, and density at this rho 1 is 1.225 kg upon meter cube. Okay. So the density variation again is a function of T2 upon T1, which we had derived using standard atmosphere, which is minus of G naught by AR plus 1, right. So I can find out for the gradient layer, right, given the altitude, let us say in our case which is 2 kilometers, given the altitude, what I can find, I can definitely find out what is delta H, which is H2 minus H1, and then multiplying it with the lapse rate, what I get is, by plugging in the information of T1, and I will be knowing what is the corresponding temperature at that particular altitude using the T2 and T1, and we know what is the lapse rate, and R is a universal gas constant for air, which is 287 joule per kg Kelvin, right. So by, and G naught of course we know is 9.81 meter per second square. So plugging in these values, what I will be able to find out what is P2 and what is rho 2, right. So similarly for isothermal layers. So isothermal layers is constant temperature regime, right. For constant temperature regimes, P2 is equals to P1 times e raised to the power of minus G naught by RT times delta H, right. e raised to the power of minus g naught by RT times delta H. Similarly, rho 2 is equals to rho 1 times e raised to the power of minus g naught by RT times delta H. So, once I know what is T is nothing but the temperature of that temperature of respective isothermal layer. Okay. And then I do not think there are new any other new variables that we need to discuss. So, using these equations, let us now write a subroutine. So, for that I will take help of MATLAB. So, I will try to first clear all the data from the memory. So, I am closing any other windows that are opened and I am clearing the screen. What I am CLC helps you, let us say there is something here, right? Let us assume there is some details there, and then when I first I would like to save this. This was our example one which we have solved in our previous lecture. I named it as performance underscore level flight. I wish you should also do that. And then the second example is for this one we are talking about density, right? So, this is density. Okay. Now, I have to make it as a function that we will finally convert. No? First, let us try to write it as a normal dot m file, normal program. So, this will help clear all, close all. We will try to remove everything from its memory, which is the workspace here. You can see it removes everything from the memory and it will clear the editor page here, clear the command window here. Right? So, from then you start writing the code. Okay. So, first thing I would like to do is consider the input of z, right? What is the altitude here? Let us say z is my altitude, which is equals to, let us say h that you are considering. Otherwise, z is my altitude that is considered, right? So, input, I will consider this as an input, enter the altitude of flight in meters, right. So, this will be an input for this program. Okay. So, now once I get the height, then I should be knowing what is the corresponding g acting at that altitude, right, which is g is equals to, or say r, the radius of earth, which is why we need is we'll try to convert this geometric altitude to geopotential altitude by means of h is equals to r times hg, right, r is radius of earth, small r times hg, or say the h is nothing but z input here, upon r times hd upon r plus hd. You can refer our discussion regarding standard atmosphere. We have discussed a bit during this during the introductory lectures of this course as well as during our previous course, right. In the previous course we have derived it in detail. So, r plus z, right. Okay. So, z is nothing but the geometric altitude that you consider, rz times rz upon r plus z here, okay, which is and then we need the input of this radius of earth, which is 6400 kilometers approximately, that to be precise it is 6356766 is the radius of earth in meters. So for a given geometric altitude, you now converted it to geopotential altitude, right? So for example, now what we first we need to see whether the input altitude, whether it falls in geometric isothermal layer or gradient layer. Let us say if at all this z is greater than or equal to 0, right, and z less than 11 kilometers, right, this is 11,000 meters, is not it? So, less than or equal to 11,000 meters, let us assume. Okay. So, then this falls in gradient layer, right. In that case, what I have is P2 or P is equals to P naught, which is at sea level, let us say P naught is at sea level. So, P naught times T2 upon T1, okay, T upon T naught again, yeah. T is the temperature at this at that particular altitude, T times T naught raised to the power of, we just discussed, right, is not it? So, this particular equations, T2 by T1 raised to the power of minus G naught by AR. So, we are talking about this particular equation, T2 by T1 raised to the power of minus G naught upon A times R. Okay. So, for this particular gradient layer, so what we are talking, if this falls into this category, then what we are talking about is a gradient layer 1. Okay. For this, what is the value of A? A is equals to minus 6.5 times 10 raised to the power of minus 3, right. We need to talk in terms of meters, we have to make sure that the units are consistent. So, lapse rate, I would like to comment this as lapse rate in Kelvin per meter, right, Kelvin per meter. So, before, okay, and then this is static pressure. At the required altitude. Okay. So, what you get here is in Pascal, Pa or Newton upon meter square. So, that is the output from this particular equation. Okay. So, the script at line number 12 gives you the output of pressure, static pressure at that particular altitude, and then say I need to find out density. So, den, let us assume den is the corresponding density at that particular altitude, which is equals to den naught, right, that is density at sea level. Otherwise, you, instead of den, you can say rho r h rho density is equals to rho naught r h rho naught, right, times T2 upon T1, I am just copying this. So, T2 upon T1 raised to the power of minus G naught by AR. So, minus 1, right, or if you take minus common, it will become plus inside. So, let me, I will just try to take this inside. So, this is like G naught by AR plus 1. So, hold raised to the power of minus, this will also work. So, you may not this extra ampersand what you call brackets may not be required. So, what you get is a density at the required altitude. at the required altitude in kg upon meter cube, right. So, what you get is a density at that particular altitude. Now, yeah, this is done. So, this is what we require, right, is not it? But how can this equation be, let us say the line at line number 12, how can this script be executed? Because we have quite a good number of unknowns here, is not it? So, here P naught is unknown, T is unknown for this gradient layer at that particular altitude, A is given for this particular layer, A is known, R is unknown. So, let us initialize the input variables here. Say R is 287 joule per kg Kelvin, right, specific. So, this is universal gas constant, for air, which is in joule per kg Kelvin, okay, joule per kg Kelvin. And then what do you require here is P naught at STP, at mean sea level, P naught is 1.01325 multiplied by 10 raised to the power of 5, right. This is in Pascal. So, 1 atmosphere. So, atmospheric pressure, otherwise static pressure or atmospheric pressure at sea level in Pascal. And then rho naught, that is density at sea level, which is 1.225 kg upon meter cube, right. Density at sea level in kg upon meter cube, okay. And we also know what is temperature at sea level, which is 288.16 Kelvin. Temperature at sea level in Kelvin. Okay. So, we have inputs now. So, the required inputs, but we T naught is known, P naught is known. In order to solve this equation, I need to know what are the variables on the right hand side, right. P naught is known as an input, T naught is known at sea level, G naught is known. G naught is also not given here. So, what we can do is G naught is equals to 9.81 meters per second square. So, acceleration due to gravity at nacelle, okay. So, G naught is given, G naught is known, and then what we need is R is known, yes. So, the only unknown is T. So, we know from the definition of A, lapse rate, right. So, we can now find out what is the T at that particular altitude is equals to T naught plus, which we just discussed, A times delta H, right. That is delta H. So, what is delta H? This is like temperature at the required altitude. In Kelvin. So, del H is nothing but delta H is delta H, delta underscore H. So, let it del underscore H. So, in order to execute this this script at 17 lines, line 17, we need to know A is input, right, T naught is input again. What is del H? So, del underscore H that we considered here is equals to z minus, z is the input altitude, right, is not it, z minus 0, nothing but from sea level, right, is not it. So, this is like okay. So, instead of 0, what I will say is z minus H1 here, okay, where for the first layer the H1 is 0, is not it? Do you accept that? So, for this first layer, so the for this first isothermal gradient layer H1 is 0 here. So, H1 let us say that will be the difference there. So, then H1 is equals to 0 here. For gradient layer 1, that means, so this H1 is equals to 0. Okay. So this will fetch me the data. If not, else if this particular z, if let us say if we want to find out at 13 kilometers altitude, right, density and other parameters at 13 kilometer altitude, if the flight is at 13 kilometers, so 13 kilometers talks about isothermal layer, which is this, it falls somewhere here. So 13 kilometers, so we need to talk about equations that corresponds to this particular isothermal layer, right. So which means we need to talk about these equations. So instead of those which we have used for gradient layer, we will just replace them by these two equations, so that we will complete the details or modeling of isothermal layer here. So if z is less than or if z is greater than 11 kilometers, right, z is greater than 11 kilometers and less than or equal to 25 kilometers, right. So, we know for this particular isothermal layer, we have constant temperature, right, they are characterized by constant temperature. So, what I will say is this is isothermal layer 1, okay. And then what is H1? H1 for this is 11 kilometers, right, because it starts at 11 kilometers. So, this is the starting of that H1 talks about starting of that particular layer, right. So, and then T of this at this particular condition is the temperature for input temperature for this isothermal layer. For example, for this isothermal layer P1 corresponds to this particular point at 11 kilometers, P1 corresponds to 11 kilometers. And P2 corresponds to any other point within this isothermal. Similarly, rho1 here corresponds to density at 11 kilometers for this isothermal layer. And similarly, T1 corresponds to, and T1 is equals to T2, and it is equivalent to this particular value 216.66. So, the T1 there or the T there is equals to 216.66 Kelvin. Okay. So, what is P1? So, which you can identify from here, from the above program, if you plug in, let us say, if you plug in what is at 11 kilometers, you can use those values and find out what is P1, which I already did it. So, what I will do is, so P1 at this particular altitude is equals to 22700. This is in again Pascal. I am not giving the details, or say otherwise, this is static pressure at 11 kilometers. At 11,000 meters, okay, and then density 1, okay, is equals to what is the density at 11 kilometers, which is 0.36480, density at 11 kilometers. So I have the initial conditions for this particular So for this particular isothermal layer, right, and then I will be able to find out what is the corresponding pressure P. So pressure P is equals to P1, because we are talking about isothermal layer, the initial conditions of isothermal layer we considered as P1 here, right, isn't it? So for this is the P1 for this particular isothermal layer, and whereas P1 for the gradient layer is nothing but P0, right. When you talk about next isothermal layer, then P0 may be different, you know, next gradient layer, let us say. So for example, if you consider next gradient layer here, then P1 should corresponds to the pressure at 25 kilometers altitude, static pressure and density at 25 kilometers altitude, right, that you need to take them as an input. Okay. So P1 is a P is equals to at that particular altitude in isothermal layer, which is P1, which is at 11 kilometers altitude, times e raised to the power of minus g naught by ar minus, sorry, rt, g minus of g naught by rt times delta h. So g naught, so I will write g naught times delta h in the numerator multiplied by del underscore h. So delta h, I will copy this for this particular isothermal layer. What is the corresponding delta h? Difference in altitude. So there is a small correction here. We have considered h1 as 11,000 meters, right? So this is in geometric altitude. We need to convert, because z is in geopotential, h1 should also be in geopotential altitude. So we need to convert this h1, the initial height of this isothermal layer, to geopotential altitude. Either, no, we can use this particular equation again and replacing z with that h1 here, like otherwise. So let us see, you can either give this as an input, for example r into z. So here h1 is 11,000 where I need to first give the details of r. R is, let us say I execute this program till this, no, okay. So I will enter the value of r here. So this is like calculator. So r times 11,000 upon r plus 11,000. So you can directly use this as h1 there. If not, what you can do, you simply consider this, like r is anyways given as an input to this program. So r times h 11,000 upon r plus h, r plus, that is initial altitude of this isothermal layer, which is 11,000 meters. Okay. So it is now converted to geopotential altitude. So z minus h1 will give you the delta h for this particular isothermal layer, and the corresponding pressure at this particular altitude, the static pressure at this required altitude, this is what this particular equation returns. Then so yeah, g naught times del h, I am sorry, there is something more here, g naught times del h upon d naught times del h upon rt, right, capital R times what is the corresponding temperature for this isothermal layer, which is T, 216.66 Kelvin. Okay. So and the corresponding density,
at this row. So since so this is den 1 or row 1, otherwise I can say R H O row 1, this is like row 1 times e raised to the power of minus g naught times delta h upon r t. So this is the density at that required altitude in kg per meter cube. That's it. We are more or less done with the required outputs and end, right? So this ends the if loop here. If the entered input value is in this range, like a gradient layer range, so this particular block of the code will be executed, and else if it falls in this isothermal range, so this particular code will be executed. So after that we will end this program. So what I need as an output is, let us say P pressure, let us say output is equals to P T, or say let us say density and then pressure P, and then T is the temperature. Let us run this program. So enter the altitude of flight in meters. Let us say I want at sea level. Let us see what it is going to return. So what I have is, so if it is, so the first one is greater than or equal to 0 rho naught times. So there is a small correction here. Earlier here delta h should not be z minus, it should be h minus h1. So there is a small mistake, so please correct it. And then the pressure at sea level is 1.01325. earlier I entered it as 1.0325, right? 3125 something, so I missed this one. So please do this corrections. So 1.01325 multiplied by 10 raised to the power of 5 is your static pressure in Pascal at sea level. So and then, so the delta h should be the altitude, input altitude, or the query altitude in geopotential altitude, and then h1 should be the for the first gradient layer it should be 0, and for the second gradient layer again h1 should be in geopotential altitude, right? So which is 11 kilometers, the isothermal layer starts at 11 kilometers, so we need to convert that to geopotential altitude. Again delta h remains same, h minus h1, h is the query altitude, and h1 corresponds to this particular, for this particular loop h1 is from this equation, from the above equation, and this is like using geopotential altitude you get 216.7835, right? So if you solve, if you run this program for 11 kilometers, you will get this as a input, right, for this particular else if condition. And then we are more or less ready. So what I will try to display instead of output here, I'll simply display rho P pressure temperature, right? So let's run this program. I need to enter the altitude, say at 0 kilometers or 0 meters in meters, right? I need to enter it in meters. So at 0 meters, that is at sea level, it is 1.225, and pressure is at pressure is 1.01325 10 raised to the power of 5 Pascal, and temperature is 288.16 Kelvin, right? So let's now run this for at say 5 kilometers altitude, which is 5000 meters. So these are the corresponding values. So now you will get this value. So this is in gradient layer. You can run this program for say 13 kilometers. Okay, there is some small error in this isothermal layer equation multiplied by the variable E. So this should be exponential, right? EXP, please. EXP, again the same thing, EXP exponential. EXP. Okay, let's run this again. So let's enter the query point, query altitude, which is an isothermal layer at 13,000 meters. So now you get the corresponding density, rho, pressure, and temperature. So yeah, with this we can say this this program works. So I would like to make this as a function, as I told you, which means so the output that I expecting is first. Function, this is the syntax for this. So function of, so the output that I would like to see from this function is rho and pressure, right? So let us say rho and pressure is equals to, or simply whatever, you can also take out the temperature T. So you will get the output as this with these three variables. So I can use any one of the variable wherever I require. So rho, P and T. And then given the name of the function should be same as name of your file that you are going to save, right? So that is density. And then so what should be the input value? It should be z, right? So z is the input from here, which we initially took as an input directly, right? So I am not displaying this. What I will do is return this function after this. That's okay, you can leave it like this. So I have saved this as a function, right? So now I'll close this function, okay? So now you can see this has become a function. So this is a M code, and that is, so I can group them by type. So you can see this. So this has become a function. For example, if I simply say, so density, okay, density at what altitude, say at 1 kilometer, okay. So answer is 1. You will get only the first variable as an output here. Okay, let me open this function. Okay, let's save this, then run this program again. In the command window, when you don't assign any particular value, right, to this function, any variable to this function, so it will directly give the first variable as an output here, right? So which is the density is the first output from this function. So instead, let us assume AA is equals to density. So let's just check whether this function is working or not. So what the function is going to return, it's going to return you density, pressure and temperature. That means you need, if you have to find out these three variables, right? So this is the way we need to call this function. Whatever the variable that you want to call, so let us say if you want the three variables as an output, then you have to mention these three variables here while calling this function. If you by default, if you just call this density function, let us say density of density at then this function density at say 1 kilometer, so it gets it returns only the first variable, which is density here. This is the first variable, right? First output from this function. So if you want all the three, then you need to mention density, pressure, temperature. So what you get is density, pressure and temperature at this query point, right? So this function is working fine, okay? So now I have saved this as a function. I will be using this function inside whenever I would like to figure out what is the density at a given altitude. Okay, so that's the reason why I explicitly mentioned it as density. And without, if I don't inquire about this P and T, it will just return density as an output here. Right. So I wish you should also complete this exercise. Okay. Now let us get back to our initial problem where we need to find out what is. So we need to find out what is the power required, right? That was the initial question. Consider the delta wing UAV presented in example 1 and find out the power required when the takeoff angle of attack is maintained as 5 degrees here. Okay. So let us now create a new script. So let us say clear all, close all, CLC. So just before that we will look at the steps that you are going to follow. Okay. So this is steps we need to follow is first of all steps for power estimation, right, during takeoff. Okay. So first step is what are we considering the input, right? Alpha takeoff maintained is input here. So you can in fact vary this and see if you vary different angles of attack what is the corresponding variation in takeoff distance, takeoff time, right, and then what is the power required and the thrust required. So once you have this, using CL, right, is equals to CL naught plus CL alpha times alpha takeoff, find CL prime, right. So now once you have CL prime, you need to find out V prime, assuming this particular CL prime, when you make the aircraft to move at V prime, you will be able to generate lift equal to weight of the aircraft, so that you can claim that you are airborne, right. So CL prime, and consider V takeoff with a factor of safety, which is 1.2 times of V prime here. Okay. So this CL prime depends upon alpha takeoff. If you are able to produce alpha stall here, then this will become CL max, right? The corresponding CL prime becomes CL max. But right now, for this particular UAV, the takeoff angle of attack is given as 5 degrees. So this will not be alpha stall anymore, then it will not be CL max, right? And V stall. So we are making it a more general case, right? And the fifth point that you have to look at is what is the corresponding takeoff velocity for this configuration. So if you have to achieve this takeoff velocity, what will be the acceleration? A acceleration that you need to produce is V takeoff minus initial velocity. Initial velocity is 0 upon time, right? So assuming a uniform acceleration to achieve this velocity, takeoff velocity, what we have is VTO upon T, okay, where initial velocity is 0 meter per second. So if we have to achieve this acceleration, why we are calculating this? We need to find out what is the ultimate, let us say at a later stage, we will come up with T is equals to this particular equation. So the T is equals to M times A. So we need input A here. So how do you find out A there? So this is like M times A plus D plus mu times W minus L. This is what we require, isn't it? So D is a unknown, A is unknown. So A we are finding out from here. So we'll see how do you find A. So this, if I want to find T, I need to know what is A, D, and L. So mu is given as an input, this is an input, mu is an input, and yeah, we do not know what is L here, right. So but we figured out what is L prime, right. So and this implies L is equals to, yeah, okay. So CL prime, right. So you know what is V prime, and similarly you can find out what is L prime, which is, or L during the, for that particular flight condition, which is half rho V square. So we are talking about, so thrust required during takeoff, right? Final. So you need to figure out this velocity. Let us make this as an explicit step here. So let us say there is another step which talks about L is equals to half rho V takeoff square S times CL prime. So CL prime is what you are going to get maximum, because you are not, you will not be able to change the angle of attack when it is during the ground run, right? It is already fixed because of the way it was designed, the undercarriage was designed, right? And so, and the based upon the what you call mount wing incidence angle. So, but we do not have a wing incidence angle here, it is a wing alone configuration. So, what the maximum the CL that you can get at the takeoff velocity is half rho V takeoff square times S times CL prime, right. So, this will be definitely, you know, more of the configuration, ok. So, if it achieves this particular condition, so for a given velocity, ok, or to be frank, you can even neglect this lift so that you will get to know what is the maximum thrust required during takeoff. If you can neglect this particular quantity, assuming the lift is not so high, right. So, you can get so similar to that of condition when you just started the ground run, lift is 0. So, mu times W is a drag or the resistance due to friction, right. So, but at takeoff you have lift, right, almost during the entire procedure, which is W minus L, ok. So, now this will be another step where you will find out what is CL prime, and then similarly you find out what is drag, which is half rho V square S times CD naught plus K CL prime square, ok. So, this is a step before this. Let me say this as step 7. You have step 8 here, and the step 6 should be like, how do you decide this? We know S is equals to ut plus half at square, right, is not it? So, from here, since the initial velocity during this ground run is 0, assuming a constant acceleration, so what you have is S is equals to half at square. So, this implies once you substitute this, the acceleration will be S is equals to V takeoff upon multiplied by T upon 2, right, ok. So, now what you need to decide is what is the length of the runway, right. Depending upon the length of the runway, you will be able to find out what is the corresponding time required to achieve this particular velocity, right, assuming a uniform acceleration. And once you know what is the V takeoff and V and the time, you know V takeoff, and once you figure out what is the time taken for this takeoff, so you will be able to find out the required acceleration. So, this acceleration can further be used in this equation to find out what is the takeoff thrust required. And then, so there are many methods, like this is the one that I generally adapt, and the power required for takeoff is equals to takeoff thrust required for takeoff times the velocity takeoff. So, this will give the maximum power, right. So, I am not doing it for the entire process, right. So, what is the power requirement variation from 0 to the maximum or the point where you achieved V takeoff. I am just talking about the final number V takeoff, what is the power required at V takeoff. So, that will be the maximum anyways. So, I would like to see that what is the value and its variation with takeoff distance, how it is varying with takeoff distance. So, the input variable here is takeoff distance, it is a variable, input variable. So, I keep varying the takeoff distance, I make it as a variable of this subroutine. From there I will be able to figure out what is the time taken to achieve that V takeoff velocity, right. So, what is the time taken to achieve V takeoff, ok. So, once I know this particular time, I will be able to find out acceleration, which is step 5. Acceleration for takeoff is required is V takeoff upon time. So, that means the length of the runway matters here, how much length of the runway it is available for you. So, from there find out what is lift, what are these factors, Right. So mu is given as an input, is a you can have acceleration as an input for equation 8, right, or step 8, and drag from step 7, and as well as this mu, which is w minus l from. So at takeoff, to be frank, this particular value is 0 takeoff. So see, this value keep decreasing as the velocity increasing, because the lift keep increasing, isn't it? So at 0 velocity you have the maximum, which is mu times w at mu times w, and at v is equals to 0, and this equals to 0, and this is 0 at l is v takeoff, assuming all. So v takeoff is equals to 0. At v takeoff it is at v takeoff this is 0. Why? Because w is equals to l, or in fact l is greater than w. So this becomes negative. So let us keep it as it is for the time being, so for the initial program. So we are going to write another subroutine. So now the aim is input, okay. So no need of input. If I just want to see the screen command window, then okay, press enter to process the code. So now alpha t, takeoff velocity. So we are using the same aircraft, right, isn't the same UAV. So performance, instead of level flight I will say takeoff, okay, save. In fact, not exactly the performance, we are talking about power requirement, okay. So and we were told that we can use the data from the previous aircraft. So let me plug in all these variables directly from this previous program. So for takeoff performance, these are the input geometric parameters, because since the UAV is same, so all these parameters remain same. And then alpha takeoff, right, so this is like the second block. So takeoff input conditions. So what are the takeoff input conditions? Alpha, right? Let me say it as AOA, angle of attack underscore TO, takeoff, right? That is which is fixed, which is constrained due to the design of undercarriage, which we discussed here, isn't it? So it is constrained because of the design of the undercarriage. So alpha takeoff is fixed due to during takeoff. Say if you don't when you can't deploy flaps for that particular UAV, you can't change or alter the CL value during the takeoff, right, for this particular configuration. So angle of attack during takeoff is 5 degrees, that is what it was mentioned. So 5 times pi by 180, I am converting it to radians. So this is in radian. So takeoff angle of attack in radians, okay. So also we require aerodynamic parameters as an input, right. So we will just copy paste these values here, and then CM alpha is also given, okay, in K. We may not be requiring all these parameters, but still we will try to copy them and then delete it, whatever that are not required. So CD naught is 0.03, CM naught is 0.01, CM naught is not required, CM alpha, CM delta is not required, and then CL delta is not required for our current program. Okay. So these are the few aerodynamic parameters that we need to give as an input. Apart from this, takeoff conditions, what we have is mu, right, mu or coefficient of friction, say it is 0.05, right, coefficient of friction, okay. So and then what do I require as an input? Nothing else, I guess. So coming back to this, so alpha takeoff is an input from here, and then yeah, so CL naught is input, CL alpha is input, which you already copied. The aerodynamic parameters are copied. Now let us find out what is CL prime here. So CL prime, so now let us start programming. So that means this entire steps, so what I need to find out is CL prime, right? CL 1 let it be is equals to CL naught, which is as an input here, CL naught plus CL alpha. I just copy this so that I will not make any mistake here. CL alpha times alpha, this alpha is nothing but AOA underscore takeoff. Okay. So CL alpha is in per radian, and then alpha is also in radians. Okay. So this with this CL1, I will be able to find out what is V1. V1 is equals to square root of 2 times W underscore S wing loading, right, upon density, density times, we will see what is the density, density times CL1. Okay. So this is your V1, so V takeoff, V underscore TO, TO stands for takeoff. So V takeoff is equals to 1.2 times of V1, let us assume that. Okay. And then what I need to find, so this, so the acceleration, so S is a variable here, so depending upon the value of S, I will be able to find out what is the corresponding time taken for takeoff. So T for takeoff, right, T for takeoff is 2S upon V takeoff, right, 2 times S, S underscore TO takeoff, right. Okay. Upon V underscore takeoff. Okay. So now S is a variable here, right, is not it? So what I will do is for S underscore takeoff. Okay. So S underscore takeoff is varying from what? Say let us start with 10 meters, or say let us start, yes, 10 meters, when increase it by 10 meters every increment, and it should be up to 200 meters, let us say. Okay. So if say this is my takeoff distance, then every time all AOA is constant, CL1 is constant, so that is not a variable here. So V1 is also not a variable, so V takeoff is not a variable here. So what is the variable is time to takeoff, because it depends upon S takeoff, right. So S takeoff is a variable, so automatically T to takeoff will also change. So let us say this is I comma 1 depends upon S takeoff there, right. So I will try to store this S takeoff also as a new variable, S underscore takeoff, right, capital takeoff is for storage purpose. So I am storing this as what I comma 1 is equals to S underscore takeoff. Okay. Distance for takeoff in meters. So V takeoff anyways is not a variable. So it depend, can you see that, like, can you appreciate this? A takeoff is constant, and hence CL1 is constant and V1 is constant, because we are not changing the aircraft, right, and then at a given altitude this is constant. So here density should be an input, right, isn't it? So what I can do is press enter to the process the code. Instead of this, the input that I would like to take is z, right. Let us say z is equals to, oh, Have we used z anywhere here? No. So z is equals to is an input. Let us enter the altitude of flight. So since I am asking for only one output, so it automatically returns density, right? So that means, so let me do that as well. So density is equals to den, let us say den is equals to density of z, right? So I'm querying this, so I'm labeling only I require only one variable here, right, which is density for this particular program. So I'm calling only one output here, which is den, right? So den is equals to density of z, returns only first output, which is density of, so it was considered here, okay, that I'm trying to delete this part. So this now like user's choice, you can enter the density of altitude of flight, enter the altitude of flight in meters, right? So now that comes in as an input here accordingly, okay. So S takeoff is clear, which is from here, and then using the same S takeoff I'll be able to find out what is time to take off. So for this program we require some inputs to follow, which is I is starting from 0, right? So for storage purpose, so I is equals to I plus 1, okay. And then so we need to find out what is the acceleration required, which is v takeoff times t upon t. So this is an approximation, acceleration for takeoff, again it is a function of distance, right, that is available. So takeoff distance that is available, so which is again v takeoff. So v takeoff is constant upon t to takeoff, right, which is a variable I comma 1. So whatever the acceleration for takeoff depends upon that particular t takeoff, right. So for that particular, and which in fact depends upon that s takeoff, which is a variable of this program, right, and then input variable in fact there. So a takeoff is done. Now I can find out what is CL. So mu is also required. So mu is given. So what I require further is what is D and what is L, right? Let us assume let us assume there is no L acting here. Okay. So let us also neglect this so that we have adequate drag. You know, adequate friction still at the takeoff time, right? So which is mu times W. Or you can say this prime is equals to, when you run at this particular velocity this will automatically disappear, is not it? If you plug in that, this will automatically disappear. So you can do that, but what I will try to do is I will take some, at least, so at takeoff this is lift is definitely equal to weight, so this becomes 0, but still I would like to have it just before takeoff. I want to have say about 50% or say 10% of this, 10% of this particular mu times W, right? That is that I would like to consider still as a significant number during takeoff, right? So let me use that 90%, so 10% of that mu times W, instead of W minus L I would like to use thrust during takeoff is equals to, so this is again a variable, right, isn't it? So thrust during takeoff times I comma 1 is equals to mass times mass of the aircraft times acceleration to take off, comma 1, okay, plus the drag that you need to overcome, and then plus the frictional force mu times w minus L, right. So, but I would like to omit this L, okay. I would like to omit this, omit this L, and then take 10% of this, right, 0.1 times 10% of this mu. This is at the takeoff condition, right. I am trying to take the frictional force as 10% at static force, right, during the static condition, okay. So, mu times W, mu is as an input, W is the weight of the aircraft which we have. So, small w, is it? This one is small w. So, let us change this thing to small w. So, this will automatically become an input from this geometric parameters, and mass of course is considered as an input. So, mass times the acceleration plus drag times mu, right. So, this is what the total thrust required. So, but for this equation to solve, we need to know what is drag here, right, isn't it? So drag again is a function, right, isn't it? So drag of comma 1, will it be? So drag is half half rho v square. V is nothing but here v take off, right. So, it will not be a variable anyway, v take off square, half rho v square times reference area times c d naught plus k times CL square, okay. So, CL is lift coefficient, CL 1 square here, which is CL 1 square, which is constant. So, this is not a variable here of this program. So, this is simply drag, you are figuring it out based upon V takeoff square times reference area CD naught plus KCL 1 square, okay. This will get you the details of drag. So, I think we are more or less done. So, the power required for takeoff is I comma 1 is equals to power required is thrust required during takeoff times I comma 1 times velocity during takeoff. Okay. So, let us end this program here. So, now the output here will be, so based upon the takeoff distance, so the variable here is a takeoff distance, and you will find out what is the time for the takeoff, to happen, and then acceleration that is required, and then the thrust as well as the power required. So, once you know what is the thrust and power required, you will be able to understand the requirement from your power plant, right. So, this has to be delivered by your power plant to this particular UAV, okay. So, let us have a pictorial let us have a plot of these variables with takeoff distance, right. So, figure 1, it is subplot. So, how many variables I can see? 1, 2, 3, 4, right, 4 variables here. So, the 4 variables here are, let us have 4 comma 1 comma 1 is a subplot, and we are plotting what takeoff with respect to takeoff distance, how this is varying, right. So, S underscore takeoff on the x axis, and then first thing that I would like to know is what is the power variation due to takeoff. So, power variation during takeoff. Y label So I can simply copy this. Okay. My label is power to takeoff. Okay. Power underscore T underscore O. Power takeoff in watts. Okay. I'm not mentioning the unit, but that is in watts. Okay. So this is in newtons and this is in watts. So subplot, this is done. I'll paste this and then say subplot 4/1 of 2, 3, and 4. The second one I would like to see what is the thrust required for takeoff, and then the third one I will talk about acceleration during this takeoff and its variation with the takeoff distance and the time taken for the takeoff to have and the time required for takeoff. So this is like thrust for required and then acceleration in meter per second square, time in seconds. Okay. So this is x label. Yes. Takeoff s underscore t underscore o, right? It's takeoff distance in meters. So I'm not giving the units here. Let's say you can still have watts, right? In the brackets we mention units as watt, and then thrust for takeoff is newtons, and then this is in meter per second square, and this is in seconds. Okay. So just let's run this code. So from the question, if you look at the question, so we need to find this takeoff performance from a runway which is at 1000 meters, right? So with a propeller efficiency of 0.95, yeah, we forgot to mention about this. So this is like power required, right? So power required during takeoff, PR during takeoff, let us say this is power required during takeoff by the aircraft, and now the engine has to deliver a shaft power, right? So ultimately, so the engine or the brushless motor here has to deliver the shaft power. So the shaft power that engine needs to deliver should be power available upon, or power available which is equals to power required by the system here, right? So this is power required by the system upon shaft power. So the shaft power that the engine has to deliver is power required by the system upon efficiency of the propeller. So let us say efficiency of the propeller here is input aerodynamic characteristics. Let us say efficiency underscore P, propeller efficiency, right? Otherwise eta P is equals to efficiency of the propeller is 0.95 is given from the data. So the power that need to be delivered, or PS is shaft power, let us say. So PS is shaft power during takeoff is depends upon the power required by the system upon efficiency of the propeller, okay, EFF underscore P. Fine. So let me add one more plot here apart from the power required. So it's, say let's have 5 subplots here. So this is 5/5 of 2, 5/3, and 5/4. So 5 of, let's say this is third one, this is fourth one, this is fifth one, okay. This is second one. I want to add one more. This is power required, it becomes PR and PR underscore takeoff, right? So let us say this is power, shaft power that need to be delivered by the engine. So okay, So this becomes the first plot here. Again, this is in bots. Okay. So we'll run this code. I think the earlier code is already okay. I have break this code. Now I'll run this again. So now it'll ask us to give an input, enter the altitude of flight in meters. So that is 1000 meters, right? So okay, there is some error here. We'll just see. So this is mu times W, right? So here mu times W it is. There is okay. So we have corrected this. And then again, yeah. So this is the takeoff distance in meters, right? So this particular yeah, you can see here the x-axis is takeoff distance in meters, and time to take. So the acceleration is like at shorter distances, as we know that you need higher acceleration. So if you have a runway which is 100 meters, so you hardly require an acceleration of 2 meters per second, right? And yeah, you can see that the corresponding thrust required is about 14 newtons, which is 1.4 kgs of thrust required in this case. And then the power required for this is about 269, for takeoff is about 269 if you want to make it takeoff within 90 meters distance, right? So and then shaft power that we need to deliver is, so this is about 270 watts, and shaft power that you need is bit more than the 283 watts. Okay, so this for a brushless motor, this power need to be given from your battery, isn't it? It's a electric motor, you need to supply this power from the battery. So you have the voltage, right? You know number of cells and the voltage of the battery times the amount. So this is from here you can figure out what should be the current drawn from the battery, isn't it? So you know what is power required here, shaft power. So once you know what is shaft power required, so now I need to connect this say this brushless motor to a speed controller and a battery, let us okay. So I need to connect this brushless motor to a speed controller unit. Let us say there is a speed controller. So from this speed controller, again now I need to give power supply to this speed controller, right? So this happens from, right? So okay, so that means this battery is having certain voltage, right? So and there is a speed controller, electronic speed controller ESC, and you have your propeller attached to this. So what you are delivering is PS here. So there is, the PS is output from the motor, right? And the input is electrical power, right? Let us say P electrical. So the efficiency, electrical efficiency E, eta E is output P shaft power upon P electrical, right? So the PE is PS upon eta E. Now once you have this electrical efficiency, say about 90%, then you know what is P electrical power that you need to give. So this P electrical is equals to voltage times current, right? So now you can decide which cell, which kind of, based upon the like. So in general, these brushless motors operate over wide range of potential difference. So depending upon the requirement of this motor, you can now have a feasible have an option to select the respective voltage, right? So and then if you want to have low power, low current drawing system, then you need to choose for a high voltage supply, high voltage supply, yeah. So that means you need to go for high cell lipo batteries or lithium polymer or any other that you'd like to power it up, that you'd like to use to power up the system. So that is your electrical power required by the system, right? So this is how you can decide what is the power required during takeoff for this particular UAV. Thank you.